Sometimes in the magical land of tech, the B550 enters you. But then other times you flip the question around and you're wondering, should I enter the B550? And today we're going to be answering that question with ASRock's B550 Phantom Gaming Velocita. Now I've taken a look at the Z490 Velocita Phantom Gaming and I like where this lineup is coming at. You're getting sort of those higher end features, especially when it comes to overclocking and audio, but you're getting it around the mid-range price point. So this motherboard coming in at $220 US, though looking at the Australian pricing, it is $339 Aussie dollars. So I gotta give props to ASRock, or at least the retailers, for now starting to price these motherboards fair in relation to the USD, where in the past we were seeing these prices just be way out of proportion compared to the converted USD into Aussie dollars. However, this board right here features a 14 phase power design, 12 plus 2. We've got Nichcon 12K caps. We've got for the PWM controller, the RA229004. Then the Intersil doublers are the ISL6617As. On the Vishay SIC654 CDs, and then for the two phases on the SoC, they are ACD, and they're both 60 amps, and then we've got 60 amp inductors. The included heatsink fan weighs in at about 200 grams, and it's got pads on both the inductors and the MOSFETs. Now the temperatures on this VRM, very impressive, 23°C ambient here, scoring out of the box with a 3950X, going to 47 degrees on the heatsink, 52 degrees on the actual PCB temperatures themselves, scoring around 141 watts usage. And then from the wall, this backed that up at 202 watts. Then moving over to an overclocked 4.35 gigahertz all cores on the 3950X, we're scoring 233 watts direct draw and 322 watts from the wall, with 64 degrees on the heatsink and 73 degrees on the PCB itself. So the VRM temperatures definitely check out. It can handle the 3950X, especially out of the box. You're getting some really nice power consumption results there and temperatures. And when we overclock it, the temperatures are good. However, the doubling aspect of this VRM itself does lose a little bit of efficiency. So you will see a higher wattage consumption, at least for 4.4 gigahertz on another higher end Phantom Gaming X that I've tested on the X570 line versus this board. But overall, 4.35 gigahertz is impressive, where I've only been able to squeeze out an extra 50 megahertz in these same conditions out of the top tier boards, which do cost a lot more than this motherboard right beside me. Though the audio on this motherboard is simply top notch, minus 2.4 decibels roll off, 0 to 10 hertz. And then at 10 to 20 kilohertz, we're looking at a minus 0.1 decibel roll off. And then the crosstalk is minus 91 dB on average. However, this is up to a volume level of 90. After that, it does start to have little bursts on the left and right channel. So basically, the audio is phenomenal with great distortion numbers too. But if you're going to be using it full time, leave the volume level at 90 or below. Though under the mic import, they're using the Realtek 1220 on both the input and output, by the way. They've got noise suppression on this particular model, and this will do a good job if you don't want any noise at all, but it will leave your voice sounding a little bit tinnier than a professional device. Though for M.2, we've got the top slot here being PCIe 4 connecting directly to the CPU, the bottom being the PCIe 3 version. Both are Ultra M.2 slots, and the temperatures were absolutely fine using a PCIe Gen 4 SSD with the speeds going up to 5 gigabytes per second on the reads. Then in the middle of the board, you've got an M.2 Wi-Fi slot, which is typically smaller than your M.2 2280s used on the SSDs. The maneuvering through all the other features, nooks and crannies on this motherboard, you've got included power and reset buttons, Dr. Debug, LED readout, which is great if you want to use it as a test bed, and then testing out the memory speeds. They say 4733 megahertz plus on the OC. We tested out with 4400 megahertz memory and it worked absolutely fine with the 3950X. You've got 7 PWM fan controlled headers here, which you can control through the BIOS itself. Though speaking of the BIOS, got everything you want if you want to overclock, save profiles. Though I do, and I keep critiquing this with ASRock, I do want to see them add in that internet flash, as well as the polychrome RGB control from the BIOS itself, like they do on some of their other higher end boards. Though speaking of RGB, we've got addressable 5 volt headers on two of those, one at the top and one at the bottom. Same with the 12 volt headers, two of those, one at the top and one at the bottom. Though onto the back of the board here, you've got a HDMI out as well as 8 USB ports, two of those being USB type 3.2, one of those being a type A, one of those a type C. I did test out the USB 3.2 speeds and we're looking at some really fast speeds, the most my USB 3 SSD can handle. Then we've got those two little holes there for the Wi-Fi if you want to add that in, a 2.5 gigabits per second LAN connection, which testing this out, the speeds were absolutely fine. Then we've got the audio solutions with 5.1 manual, as well as an optical out, which I do personally love having that optical out. And lastly, we've got the power connections up the top, which is an 8+4 pin, not to be confused with NVIDIA's upcoming 12 pin proprietary connector. Though lastly, last on top of a double last, we've got here the RGB, which is on the top heatsink and also the bottom heatsink, so two areas which are included in the motherboard itself. And this now leads us on to conclusion time with the Phantom Gaming Velocita and what are my thoughts on this board. And in a nutshell, this board is simply for someone who wants to overclock and they want near the highest end results they can get, but they don't want to spend the highest end on some of those other motherboards out there. And this thing can easily take a 3950X pretty much as high as it can go, with the temperatures still remaining very well intact. And then you've got the feature set of really good onboard audio, the M.2 speeds, the temperatures, they all check out. And then lastly, of course, you've got that clean aesthetic with the RGB bling thrown in and the extra controls if you want to debug things or use it as a test bench. And so that's about it with this Velocita. It's a solid board. It didn't particularly blow me away, but the numbers coming out of it were very solid. And I hope you guys enjoyed today's review. If you did, be sure to hit that like button. And also let us know in the comments section below, are you digging this B550 motherboard, or would you rather get another B550 motherboard? Love reading your thoughts and opinions as always, just like this question of the day here, which comes from Martin Kernighan. And they ask, in your test, did you make sure the water cooler was allowed to reach equilibrium? And they're talking about this older video I did where I compared an air cooler versus a water cooler. And there's this big thing going around with water cooling. People are saying you should be testing it for over an hour to let the water essentially reach the equilibrium of the heat output of the CPU. And my problem with this is that really in a liquid cooler, most all-in-ones will have like maximum of 200 milliliters in the actual cooler themselves. And you're going to be using these coolers most of the time with an overclocked CPU. Think of maybe a 3900X, 3950X, or a 10900K. And in this case, that's about 200 watts output. And so if I put 200 mils in a kettle, which I've done just specifically for this question, you can see that the water is still going to heat up very quickly. And so for me personally, I've tested this with static fan speeds. And after about 10 minutes, you're really reaching a peak. You're not really going to see much more unless that particular water cooler with that fan setup can't really handle the wattage output from the CPU. Say, for instance, you've got a weak fan on a 120 mil rad and you're putting out 200 watts, over time that heat may rise. And that's not to do with equilibrium, that's just to do with the water cooler not being able to handle the temperatures. Though if we look at, say, a 280 mil H115i RGB Platinum, after 10 minutes, you're really not going to see a difference, especially with static fan speeds. And so other people may be confusing that equilibrium with auto fan speeds, which after a while may stay at that fan speed. I found for me personally, after about 10 minutes, providing the cooler is adequate, then it's going to give you pretty accurate results. But I usually test around here at Tokyo City for 20 minutes just to give that 100% result that I'm confident in delivering the numbers with. Even though the heat transfer numbers are a lot lower than that of aluminium or copper, it still transfers heat quite fast. And yes, to answer that question directly, the temperatures did reach equilibrium. Hope that answers that question, and I'll catch you in another tech video very soon. And if you stay this far and you're enjoying that Tech Yes content, then you know what to do. Sub button's down there, boop, 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 bing, 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 ring the bell, and I'll catch you in the next one. Peace out for now. Bye.